Hello, hello. My name is Ari Gold. I am the director of the Air Drum movie Adventures of Power, which Neil Peart was in. I'm the Guinness Book World Record holder for air drumming, and I am so psyched that after seeing some drumming in the background, I'm really psyched that Ray Luzier, who's air drumming in the background from Korn and from many other things, such as playing for David Lee Roth, which we want to talk about, is joining us, and producer extraordinaire of all things hard, Nick Raskulinecz, is with us as well. They are coming to us from Nashville. I'm in Venice, California, and we are talking about rock, drums, air drums, metal, whatever strikes our fancy. Hi, guys.
Hi.
Thank you so much for joining the Air Drummer Extravaganza. And by doing this, you are supporting Music Heritage, because anytime anyone watches or buys the movie, even watching it for free on Amazon, money gets sent to Music Heritage. So it's a beautiful thing. And Ray and I didn't meet, but we're both on the Neil Peart Festival special on moderndrummer.com, which is presenting this event. And so anyone who hasn't seen those 4+ hours of incredible stories, drumming, all about Neil Peart, please go to moderndrummer.com/shop and watch that special. So with that out of the way, I would love to know, guys, what you're doing together in Nashville right now. What's happening in that studio? Rock Falcon, Falcon Rock.
It's Rock Falcon Studios in Nashville. There's nothing happening right now. We're just kind of hanging out, doing this, and I'm working on records here, but we're kind of in a holding pattern right now because of the virus, and that's about it. There's not a lot happening, actually.
Mm-hmm. What was the last project you guys worked on together?
The Nothing.
Yeah, it was the last Korn album, The Nothing.
Uh-huh. Okay. And so how did Ray push your buttons in the most insane way? I want to hear some stories of, like, I want to hear when you guys wanted to punch each other, because you can't be this comfortable without having some moment when you wanted to kill each other.
Me pushing your buttons, you is the other way around.
All right. So how did Nick push?
I'm being sweating. Yeah, I'm like in there like bashing my brains out, sweating, dripping off. I'm thinking I just murdered, killed everybody. This is awesome. Nick, cool, man. Let's we ready to do the take now? What are you talking about? That was it, man.
Great warm-up pass. Now let's do it for real.
Nah, but he's rad though, because like he the way he goes about it, he obviously the outside ears, that's what we hire someone amazing as Nick to do what he does. Because, you know, we're trapped in, we kind of, when you write the songs, you have this, you're kind of married to the tunes, you're kind of, these parts are mean something to you, and then it takes a great outside ear to come in and go, that's cool, but what if you tried this, and what if this became the chorus instead of the verse? And then he starts to rearrange the stuff, and even down to my drumming, like hey man, you know that thing you do in the hi-hats? I'm like, yeah, cool. He's like, yeah, don't do that in the next pass. And I'm like, but that's, I always do that.
He's, I mean, like, the only thing I can think of is when I asked Ray to take his splash cymbals away.
That just doesn't work for him. Yeah. You don't like the splash cymbals.
I like one.
One cymbal.
I don't like three or four.
Yeah, I had a bunch of.
I mean, you know, you could go, you know, go all Phil Collins, Peter Gabriel, 1980, and have no cymbals.
Yeah. Well, see, I would love that, but no drummer is willing to do that. That's like making somebody shave. That's like making a chick shave her head.
Yeah, but it worked for In the Air Tonight, and I mean, you know, the one of the ultimate air drum songs.
So. Like that. Sometimes we'll do the two things separate. It's fun. It's time consuming, but it's fun. The results are great. We talked about if we ever record again together, we should do that next time. We talked about it. I mean, honestly, the moments working with this guy, the moments, there are no tense or weird. It's the exact opposite. The moments of hilarity and laughing and cracking up and roasting the shit out of each other is what happens pretty much the whole time. And then it's like, oh yeah, we're recording drums. How was that take? I don't know. I was laughing the whole time. Let's listen to it again.
Well, I mean, Ray's it, you know, Ray, you were teaching before you were like a rock star. Is that correct? Like, you were at the
Rock Star
Institute? I mean, you like the, you have a comfort where you could, it's effort. You've reached that point of mastery where it's effortless. So you can laugh your head off while you're playing.
Well, I'm very, to me, I have a long, long, long way to go, and I'm my worst critic. And it's like, I was a teacher. I started very young. You know, I moved from Pennsylvania on 180-acre farm to Hollywood Boulevard to because I knew I wouldn't meet anybody in Pennsylvania. I wouldn't be able to people like Nick and everyone in the industry. So I moved to Hollywood and I attended Musicians Institute for a year. I went to PIT and I thought I was like hot shit coming off the phone. I'm like, check this out. And it was like, and they're like, yeah, your time is not happening. Here's a metronome. And I was like, oh, okay. And it was just, and then the humbleness just, it just knocked me down to size. And like, your jazz is not good. Your Latin sucks. And what's you call that, a reggae beat? And so it was like, I got my ass.
I remember saying that to you.
You did. Yeah, you hate my reggae. But like, there were so many, you know, styles. I was naive. I was 18, you know? So it was like, when I moved to LA, I went to that school, there was no rock programs. It was all like jazz, metal, or I'm sorry, jazz, you know, fusion, all the big band stuff. So I was one of the ones complaining to Ralph Humphrey and Joe Paparo, like, hey, like, get a rock program. So when I graduated by the skin of my teeth, 2 years later, they called me and said, hey, if you write a rock curriculum, we'll hire you. I'm like, I'm 22 years old, 21, whatever. And I said, that's fine. So I started at 3 hours a week and I went to 33 hours a week. And I really didn't know what I was doing, but it kind of forced me into this, like, you better get good and you better know your shit.
The best way to learn is if you're forced to teach anything, and especially winging it and faking it, and someone looking at you like you're supposed to know what you're talking about, like, it forces you to, I mean, it's like the difference between practicing at home versus playing in front of an audience. Like, the amount of muscle learning you get from the pressure of an audience, like, quadruples whatever you learn by going or whatever instrument you're learning.
Right. Absolutely.
I'm telling you, my girl, a girl I met on the beach, she's like a wannabe, she's a learning metal guitar. She's sitting there like doing scales. And I'm like, you got to turn on your amp and like let the people on the beach hear you, because it'll singe into your nerves, your mistakes and your triumphs. So teaching must have made you the drummer that you are. That's my theory. I don't know. You tell me.
Well, I mean, I moved to LA to become, you know, I wanted to be a known, respected player. You know, I didn't want to conquer the drumming world. I didn't want to be the best. I didn't want any of that. I just wanted to be in a band that kept making records, that I wanted to make a living playing music, you know, whether I did the rock star thing or, you know, I had many failed original bands like every other band in LA. Then I found out when I started joining national bands, I'm like, wow, I can pay my phone bill. And I joined the Jakey Lee band when I was 24. And I'm like, wow, I'm making steady money, and I'm in a tour bus. This is more of my style. I don't want to teach. So around, you know, I'd get these little tours around teaching. And when I finally had the David Lee Roth gig, then it was like real money, real gigs. And I'm like, wow, I stopped teaching at that point. And then I'm like, I need to do this on this level and start, you know.
Can you give us a David Lee Roth? Oh, sorry, Nick, go ahead. What was that?
I said, as soon as Ray figured out he never had to set his drums up again, he was like, this is it. I made it.
Wait, there's a roadie? Yeah.
It's true.
Can we get a day before I ask Nick about it? Well, Nick, when did you were in the LA scene and then you moved back to Tennessee. Like, did you guys meet in LA or did you start working together once you had your studio in Tennessee?
No, I moved back here in 2007.
Okay.
And I met Ray right before we made the first record we made together.
Was it called Serenity of Suffering? I'm so glad that it sticks in your mind. It never leaves his mind. SOS record.
So we never met till then, right? I don't think we met until then.
And we met at a Thai restaurant, remember? I walked in, you and your whole family were sitting there.
Yeah.
And you're like, hey man, I'm Nick. And I'm like, oh, you are Nick. What are you doing here?
Yeah, we just met haphazardly at this little Thai restaurant in this little strip mall in Tennessee.
Uh-huh.
And then we worked together in the studio for a day. And then I went on the road with Korn for like 10 days. They did like a nine-day run. And I went with them. And that's when we really started to hang out, was on that.
Are you went on the road with him. You were you recording for them, or were you like playing it underneath the stage, playing something else? Like what were you a groupie?
I was basically out in, I was standing on the side of the stage, airing everything along with them. Or I spent a lot of the time out in the crowd, actually. My whole mission of going was to actually watch the crowd and to see what the kids were reacting to.
Figure out what worked best.
And all that stuff. So I would just kind of cruise around while they were playing their set. I'd literally cruise around the whole building.
Were they testing out new material that you were going to then be recording, or was it you were just absorbing their old material so that you could get a sense of what was the best kind of vibe?
Yeah, it was the latter. We weren't even working on any songs yet. I think it was still kind of getting to know each other, period.
Because secretly you wrote all their songs. I know. I mean, you told me that backstage. I won't tell anyone. Oh, shit. Yeah, okay. So, well, that's a good way to get to know somebody. Were you like in the tour van with them, or were you following them?
We had a blast. Yeah, that was so much fun. We had a blast, and then I flew home completely exhausted, and I was like, man, I'm glad I'm not in a band.
But you played in bands before, back in the day, no?
Yeah, I played in bands. I moved to LA with my band, my best friends. We moved to LA and gave it a shot, and, you know, it didn't work out, but we did the whole thing, moved to Hollywood, and, you know, did the whole deal, man.
It was like your Rock and Roll Ralphs?
Totally, man. We lived right over off Highland and La Brea over there.
Oh, my God, you're fucking right in the center of it. I used to see Rodney Bingenheimer stumbling around there at 4 a.m. Did you ever know him?
Yeah. We used to see him at bars all the time. Yeah. It was like 95 to 2000, so it was a nice.
For those who don't know, he was, he was sort of an impresario of like the party scene going way back to like David Bowie time. And he's a fixture around the scene and particularly at Rock and Roll Ralph's at 4 a.m, kind of stumbling in with he looks like Slender Man kind of, and he'd always have some kind of dazed looking girl following him like 6 feet behind him. Am I wrong?
Rock and Roll Ralph's is the only place in the world where you can run into Paul Stanley. Yeah.
That in his bedroom. But I can't, you froze. Can one of you clap? I can't see or hear anything. Hey, John.
Uh-oh.
Okay, you're back to life. Okay, maybe it's just my system. So let's talk. I'd be curious to know, you know, that I heard from RJ Hailstorm, who I talked with a couple weeks ago, that there's some Neil Peart drums in your studio. Is that true? And I'd love to hear about your relationship with Neil. And then I don't know, Ray, if you know how intimate you were with Neil Peart. But I'd love to, you know, because in some sense Neil brought us together. I'd love to hear anything that, you know, you can share, because I know there's a lot of people who are still feeling that loss. We're at the anniversary of the loss a couple days ago, and anything you can share that might, I don't know, help people feel close, that would be sweet.
Well, I've got a drum set. So when we were making Snakes and Arrows, he had this drum set and it was awesome. It was the first kit DW built for him when he came back playing drums after his extended break. And at the end of the record, he was like, oh, you know, I've got something for you. And I was like, what? And he had a 5-piece version of his big giant drum set made, and he gifted it to me. And it was so cool, because a couple months later, we actually went to the DW place out in LA. This was still when I lived in California. This was before I moved. And Neil shows up at the house in his fucking DB Cooper. My wife Amber is like, hey, there's somebody in the car, in the driveway, in some crazy car. And I was like, oh yeah, that's Neil. He's coming over. We're going to go out to DW. So we jumped in my Suburban and drove out to DW, and all the guys were there. And he was like, da-da. And it was a little five-piece version of his drum set, which I still have, and I use it all the time, and it's amazing. And we did a whole tour of the factory together, which was super cool. And then we drove back to my house.
So freaking cool.
Dude, this is the coolest part.
Just you riding the DW with Neil. Come on.
Dude, so Neil helped me unload the drum set out of the back of my Suburban, hump it up into my house. We set it up, and we sat up there and played it together in the room for like an hour.
You play with Neil?
Yeah.
Wait, so you play drums like a Hot for Teacher style, two drummers?
No, we just it was just that one drum set, but we just took turns playing it.
Uh-huh. Like, how did it feel? I played drums in front of Neil once with my old band called the Honey Brothers, and he came to a show, and it was like a little intimate place for the release of the movie, and I'm playing drums and I'm looking out at Neil. I'm like, what am I doing? But how was it to play like for you right in front of him?
Well, that was awesome, but it was even more awesome on the last record, Clockwork Angels. We actually had two kits set up in the room, and we fully fucking had jam sessions and
wow,
drum moments, and you know, it was awesome.
Wow.
There was lots of fun jamming, you know, after everybody went to bed and it was just me and Alex some nights, you know. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm sitting there looking at the drum set and it's like, dude, I look at him and it's like, you wanna? And he's like, okay. And I'm like, all right, let's play Circumstances.
Wow.
So there were a lot of really cool moments like that, you know, and to all the Rush fans out there, yeah, I can't believe it's already been a year, but he was such an awesome person and so much fun. And we had a lot of fun together. We really did.
Yeah, the thing that, I mean, his impression, I think, to the public was like this, like super serious scientist, you know, the professor, like, but in person, there was this incredible warmth and love that I felt, you know. I mean, I also hung out with him at Don Lombardi's, you know, at DW Drums, and you know, the feeling of like welcomeness that he gave to everyone that he dealt with, and you know, his humbleness given who he was and what his reputation was amazing contrast, a beautiful thing that. And intelligence he brought to all of it. And also, you know, we talk about like learning and, you know, talking with Ray about teaching. He was always trying to learn new things, always trying to study other drummers. You know, that's why he was the professor, is because he was also a student always. So.
I think that's one thing about it, is you never stop learning, you know, no matter what you're doing, whatever instrument you're playing, engineering stuff, whatever it is, you never reach that plateau. I always tell people, if you did reach that plateau, you probably should go do something else. You lost the passion, or you lost that, you know what I mean, that drive. Yeah. Like, there's light years of stuff to go, drumming wise, I mean, just music wise. Neil being such a composer that he was, and the lyricist that he was, I mean, that's light years above so many players out there. But he didn't look at it that way. He looked at it as, I'm going to keep improving. I'm going to keep, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Constant investigation.
Yeah.
By the way, Sean Foyce says hi to Ray. The message is coming through. Sean Foyce says hi. And then also someone's asking, what was Neil's method of tuning in the studio? Oh, Sean was asking that. Like, yeah, I'd love to hear about the tuning experience of a drum set.
His drum tech, Gump, did all the tuning. He did it all with a mallet. He had like one of those mallets you hit like one of those big drums with. And he did all the tuning for everything. It was like a. They did some weird. It was like some little song that he would play.
But did he have note tuner pitch thing?
No,
like B flat?
No, he just did it all by ear.
And which is wacky, because Nick is really good at tuning drums. He's like, you know, I would be playing a take and he'd go take five. I need to tune your drums. And I'm like, what do you mean you're going to tune? And just years of doing it, he knows what he likes to hear. He knows what the drums was to sound like. So for Neil to have his guy must have been weird for you, or not weird.
I mean, it was fine for me because, you know, that drum set was really intimidating because it was really big.
Right.
And I mean, I was nervous, man, around those dudes back then. Shit.
Yeah.
For the first time I walked into the studio, what I got there before any of the, I'm not nervous around you. First time I ever walked into the studio and saw that drum set.
Okay, Ray.
I showed up before anybody else and kind of put my shit down and sat down behind the kit and was like, digga. And Gump walked in. He was like, what are you doing? Who are you? I was like, ah. I got scolded immediately, so I was nervous.
He's like, remember the Sound City movie? That was, remember?
That was cool.
Oh, was it?
Yeah. Well, I mean, that you earned confidence. I mean, you record Rush and then, you know, Korn comes in and you were able to be totally calm, which obviously then helped you to be actually yourself, which is how you bring out the best of a person, is you make them comfortable.
Yeah, so comfortable. I just want guys to play, man. I want them to play the best they can play. And while you're doing it, sometimes it might feel like the best take ever, but it might not sound like the best take ever.
And that's the thing about Nick. He knows, even as high level as Neil, he still knows even with him that he could have done something better. Yeah. Or you played that way at rehearsal or pre-pro. And there's a certain magic that was there that you're not quite capturing when it's time to cut. Yeah. And he actually pulled that out of Neil in the middle of a take. And we talked about it on my video, but tell the people that are watching but you stopped him in the middle of a take and made him do it again.
Yeah, I mean, I did that a bunch of times. I mean, the first time we started doing it, you know, immediately recording the first song, he was playing it. He played the song a couple times and I had a couple ideas and he was playing it. And I ran out into the room. I was like, hey, hold on, stop. And he's down in the pocket, not even looking at me. And I'm like, stop. And he kind of looks up and slowly kind of stops and peels his headphones off. And he's looking at me like, what? Why are you in here? You know, and I'm like, hey, dude.
Who are you again? What's your name?
Who are you? I wanted my coffee earlier. And I was like, dude, that thing, you know, try this, try that. What if you did, you know that fill you did in Vital Signs? You know, what if you did something like that, but instead of, you know, going to the crash over by the hi-hat, go to the one by the ride, and, you know, just little things like that. And then I turned around and ran out of the room. And, you know, I walked back in and Getty is looking at me like, what just happened? And I'm like, oh shit, you know, and he's like,
no one's ever done that before?
Apparently not. I mean, I don't see how you could make.
But Neil didn't blink, I'll bet, right?
No, I didn't think twice about it. I mean, whether it's him or Ray or Taylor Hawkins or Braun or.
Did you use a quick track on that record? Oh, sorry, I just lost you guys.
I used a quick track on both of the records.
Okay. Yeah, and someone's asking, any thoughts?
Yeah.
Oh, go ahead. Sorry, I'm fielding questions here too. Someone's asking, any thoughts on Bard or Kolstad? I'm reading the questions. It's okay. You know, the joy of fielding, you know.
Did you sneeze or what happened?
Hey, we are in Tennessee, man.
I don't know. That's what popped into my feed, thanks to my friend Didi. So anyway, if you don't have thoughts, that's okay. I still want to hear a Dave Lee Roth story from Ray. We talked a little about this beforehand. I know you're telling secrets.
What are you talking about, David Lee Roth? I don't know nothing about the guy. I don't know why I'm doing this with my fingers.
Yeah. So you were 22 when you got hired by him, or 23?
I was, I was 27. It was 97 when I got hired for Dave. And I didn't even know that I got the, I've told him so many stories that I could write a book just from the stories I told him.
Tell us one, because like the people... You know, it's Dave Lee Roth. There's only one Dave Lee Roth, so.
How many hours you got there, Ari, whatever
your name is. We got time.
But I got hired in 97, and when I got hired, I didn't know I got hired. It was a demo. I played on this kid named Mike Hartman, this solo record. Greg Bissonette and I shared this drumming duties, and he was kind of this pestery kid, and unfortunately, he passed of cystic fibrosis. Was an amazing guitar player. Steve Vai gave his number to David Lee Roth. long story short, well, I'm doing two demos for this kid. And then he goes, hey, David Lee Roth wants to sing over these songs. I'm like, yeah, sure he does. And sure enough, here I am in freaking Ocean Way with David Lee Roth. And my job was just to cut the two tracks again for vocals. There was nothing about a gig. There was nothing about, so I wasn't nervous. I mean, I was freaked out because I grew up with Van Halen. And Dave walks in, he just had back surgery. So he was literally in an L. He's literally like hunched over. And I'm like, wow.
Did you get down there too?
I did. I said, nice to meet you. Now.
Yeah.
But he, you know, he was asking me all these questions. I wasn't nervous because I was just doing the songs. And he'd come in from the top back or from the inside, you know, room and go, what if I said swing this and shuffle that and play a fill here and do it? And I'm like, man, this guy asks a lot of questions, you know, and I'm just doing whatever he said. And the next day, Big Ed Anderson, his bodyguard, called me up and goes, little hey, kid, you passed with the flying colors. That's what? He goes, the gig. Did he get here? He was asking all those questions. I'm like, yeah, but I just thought he was David Lee Roth. I don't know. So anyway, I got the gig. That was 8 years of my life.
Wow.
I didn't tell a story, did I? That was just the gig.
There's a story. There's...
Let me give you a quick one.
Here we go.
The watch story is the best one. So John Five and I, John Lowry, John Five is in Rob Zombie, Marilyn Manson. Everybody knows. We were in the band together. There was no bass player. Urban Bob was the fake bass player that Dave made up. And he's in, Terry Kilgore's in some of the band pictures with us. So Neil Zlozauer, the famous photographer, everybody knows Neil, was taking them. You know, Dave only takes it with Neil Zlozauer. Neil's another one's not afraid to tell Dave, that's a stupid shirt. You're going to wear that dumb thing in the photos? And Dave's like, check it out, you know, because he's not, you know, they've known each other forever. So I'm sitting there and I'm thinking I'm trying to be all cool and like posing. And I'm, you know, it's me, John Five. We're like, I don't know what the heck's going on. I'm at David Lee Roth's mansion in Pasadena. Like, I'm kind of freaking out. And I had this piece of crap Casio watch on. And I'm like, trying to be all cool and posing and check me out, you know? Like, and Dave's like leaning against me and he goes, whoa, 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 stop. And he goes, Luzier, the hell's on your wrist? And I go, it's a watch, sir. It's a Casio. He grabs the watch and he just flings it all his might across the yard. And he goes, in my van, rock stars don't wear watches, Luzier. And I'm like, oh, point taken, sir. I'll never do that again, right? So we do the shoot. I'm kind of freaking out. You know, I'm going to lose this gig because of my watch, you know. So months go by. We're 6 bucks with him. And I'm thinking buddies by then. We're really not, but you think you are. And he's on the bus, and he has a watch on. And I just went, oh. It's on now. Watch this. I'm going to be really cool right now. And they go, hey, boss, I thought you said rock stars don't wear watches. It didn't matter. I mean, I didn't even finish my sentence. And he goes, I'm not a rock star, Luzier. I'm a legend. And I was like,
yeah. I love that.
It just went on and on from there.
I'm a legend.
Yeah. That's athletic.
You know, he's not wrong.
No.
He's not wrong. I got another question, by the way. This is, how did Army of Anyone become a supergroup? Question mark, question mark, question mark. It's a very enthusiastic question.
As Robert DeLeo, for those of you who don't know, it's Robert and Dean DeLeo from Stone Temple Pilots and Richard Patrick from Filter and myself. And Robert put it as, we're not a supergroup, we're a super duper group.
What? Yeah. Isn't that a White Stripes song?
Yeah, something like that. But it was a very short-lived band. We were the guinea pigs on Firm Records, and that's one of my most proud records I've ever played on. I love that record. Those of you that are into SDP and Filter, go check that record out. It's some of definitely my favorite stuff I've ever played on.
Yeah, I'm sitting right here.
I know you didn't produce it.
Wow.
Bob Ezrin, little guy named Bob Ezrin produced that.
A kid named Bob Ezrin?
Yes, a kid. Yeah. Kiss Destroyer is one of the main reasons that I play drums to this day. Bob Ezrin's in the... But so anyway, you know, long story short, you know, one record came out, we did a short tour, but Korn was managed by the same management. So I kept asking him, like, what's up with Korn? They got Terry Bozzio playing, you know, the record. They got Joey doing the tour, Joey from Slipknot. They got Brooks Wackerman, Mike Borden's filling in. What's going on with them? They're like, yeah, they're looking for a permanent drummer. You should go try out for him. I'm like, yeah, right. Because I had like long blonde hair at the time. And I wasn't near as cool as I am right now.
You're really cool back then.
and
That was as the demise of AOA was happening. I flew up to Seattle and Joey's last gig, auditioned, learned about 33, 34 songs, played six of them. And they said, welcome to Corn, we'll see you in Dublin. Now it's been 14 years, crazy.
Wow. So,
and they still treat you like the new guy.
I'm the new guy. Hey, that's another Neil story. That's a great thing you just brought up. Because I've always been known as the new guy, right? Because the Corn's been around 26 years.
Who's the new guy too?
Yeah, totally. Well, Neil, the only time I ever met Neil was at an LA drum off, and they hid him back in the room because he didn't want to be part of the whole, because it was, you know, Peter, Chris, Bozio, all these legendary drummers there. But Neil had his own little curtained off room in the back.
Yeah.
And Chris from Fabian Symbols, a good friend of ours, comes over and he goes, he looks around, he's like, hey man, you want to meet the guy? I'm like, what's this, a drug deal? Like, what are you looking for? Like, he's like, dumbass, Neil, you want to go say hi to Neil? What? And I'm like, because there's all these drummers everywhere, and I just flew with Chris, and that's my only time I ever got to say hi to him. But I said something to the fact where, like, yeah, I'm the new guy in Korn, and he goes, well, I'm the new guy in Rush.
So,
and I just went, that just leveled everything. I go, well, thank you, man, because I'll never be, you know, I'll never feel weird about someone saying that again, because he said that.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Well, he came, I mean, he was able to make people feel comfortable. That's the thing that was, so when my movie played at Sundance, it was a total kind of catastrophe. Harvey Weinstein, who mattered at the time, walked out about 7 minutes into the movie. Wow. And so everyone starts like blogging, oh, this movie's a failure. Harvey Weinstein walked out.
Wow.
And Neil Peart was like, yeah, you believe when people say good things about you, you believe when people say bad things about you, so don't listen to anything. And that ability he had to immediately kind of see where someone's insecurity was and make them feel good was amazing. You know, like that generosity of spirit. So he said that to you as a way of like, he like made you feel good right away. Yeah. You met him once, he made you feel better. And that was the magic of the man. I mean, it was to have that level of kind of like God stature and be so, you know, giving was amazing. I'm hearing another. Oh, is that, hey, John, can you mute yourself? Okay. Sorry, I'm hearing another voice in my head.
Really?
Sorry, where was that voice coming?
Oh, that was next.
I'm hearing, I can't tell who's talking right now. I'm sorry. Well, so we got a couple more minutes. Is there anything that you guys would like to share that you're working on or that you care about in the world that you want to say to this mixed audience of air drummers and movie fans and drum fans and Korn fans and everything, production fans? I'll ask one other question. Why didn't you go? Oh, there's a bunch of questions. Sorry, I can't do them all at once. You guys speak.
You care about Nick.
I love drums.
What was your first instrument, Nick?
I actually played the drums first. And then I played guitar and then I played bass. So I kind of can get my way around those three instruments. You know, it's really those years of playing from like 14 to, you know, up until into my 30s were invaluable, you know, as far as being a producer and being able to talk to drummers with in drum terms and drum noises and sounds, and same thing with guitars and bass.
Right.
And I get to play enough still to, you know, to get my rocks off.
And that means a lot because I've worked with producers that are really good, but they don't know the first thing about any of the instruments or like, you know what I mean? And it's a weird thing when they try to convey a point because they don't, you know what I mean, they're not tell us what you crack, go to this chord or move a half step down, and they don't even know the terminology sometimes, and it's really weird. So it's like,
right,
that's what's another great thing about Nick is he'll say simple things like that, like that crash cymbal's kind of weird right there, go to this or just stay on the hats, and I'm like, wow, that, you sure? And he's like, yeah, trust me. And then listen back and be like, wow, that really worked. So that he knows all that stuff, you know.
I mean, there's not a lot of producers that will change snare heads in the middle of takes and tell the drummer not to move. Okay, don't move. I'm coming in.
Wait, so while he's like, hold.
Dude, this guy's drum heads, they look like the surface of the moon by the time you get to the second chorus.
Like within the space of one song.
Oh yeah, so I'll stop the tape and be like, dude, hold on, I'm coming in. And I'll grab a snare head on my drum key and I won't let him get up from the drum.
The movie, if people watch this talk and they can't watch the movie, it's free on Amazon Prime. It's called Adventures of Power, or you can go to airdrummer.com in the future and watch it. And the any money that comes to the movie supports Music Cares, which is particularly helpful right now because gig money for musicians has dried up, and particularly for working musicians who aren't major rock stars, it's Music Cares has really been helping people get through this crisis. So, you know, watch the movie and you're helping out, and please donate to Music Cares as well. If you have some spare change or a spare couple thousand dollars, please donate. Yeah. Okay, so that's that, but. So someone says keep talking, but like, let's see, keep talking person, what do you want us to talk about?
There's other
more David Lee Roth stories, which I would always accept. I would accept one more David Lee Roth story right now from Mr. Luzier.
Oh, well, I'm trying to see what the G rated ones I can
No, you can go up to R, just not X. But R includes a lot.
There was no X's either. Let me see. Dragon. Oh, the Starbucks one's pretty good too. I was in the studio and he goes, when I got the gig, I called Greg Bissonette because I was kind of freaking out. Greg had the gig for, you know, of course, he's on Eat 'Em and Smile, Skyscraper, and Little Ain't Enough, three amazing records. And met Greg through the years at the NAMM shows and PIT and several places. So when I got the gig, I called Greg up frantically, just like, dude, I just got this gig. And it was this big pause. He's like, you did? And I was like, yeah. He goes, man, that's so awesome. He goes, I put your name in a hat for that gig years ago and blah, blah, blah. And says, what do I do? And he's like, you know, Dave's a guy that just, you know, he's one of those guys where, you know, he's got this, well, he's this just, and he couldn't say anything. It was just this, like, there was over and over, just nothing came out. And he goes, just don't drag. I go, what do you mean don't drag? And he goes, just it was when you're playing, you know, he likes people on top of the beat. I'm like, well, I always play on top of the beat, so he's going to love me. And so that was it. There was no, like, he goes, you just got to, you'll see. It's just one of those things. And so we're in the studio, and I'm playing, and the DLR band record, the first record I ever made with him, I had my little R5, those old Roland, remember those old Roland drum machines, mm-hmm. really old
90s? Big ones.
Yeah, and they had a click track in there. I was so used to that thing. So I had it, you know, that thing, and it was, this song's gonna be 96, this is gonna be 105, whatever. All the BPMs were programmed up. Dave walks in the studio, he goes, what's that, Luzier? And I go, that's a drum machine, sir. And he looks at me, he gets a cord and yanks it out of the wall. And I go, he goes, we won't be using the click track on this record. This is old school, this is rock and roll. You got feel, son, you got heart, you got soul. You know, this kept going on and on. So I'm like, yeah, okay, great. So we're in there, and I'm like, now I have no conception of time. I'm relying on me, which is pretty scary in the studio, as everybody that's ever made a record knows. The bongo player provides the time.
They're waiting for the drummer to play the drums in time.
Right, something. Yeah, yeah. Time is
four distinct eras of Rush.
Yeah.
Overall, if I had to pick one record, man, it might be Fly By Night.
Really?
It could be Fly By Night.
Wow.
I know, right?
It is a great one.
Let's see.
It's not one of my, like, first picks.
I mean, I love every song. The energy on that album is over the top. The guitar is awesome. I love that album.
Wow.
I'd probably be Fly By Night.
I think mine's going to be Moving Pictures.
Yeah, it's Moving Pictures for me too.
That's the first time I really discovered them. You know, I heard Working Man, I heard a couple of the older ones, but that's the first record that I bought, the vinyl. I bought Moving Pictures, and I remember, like, back then you could stack records. Remember mm-hmm. when we did yeah. the right? And I'd be just playing drums to every record that I had. And I remember like Back in Black was on, you know, every song, and Moving Pictures would come on. I'm like, how come I can't keep up with, you know? So I knew there was something, you know, at a very young age. But I think that's the one that sticks out for me, you know. But to be honest, I'm not saying it because this guy's sitting right here, but Clockwork Angels is probably my top three Rush albums ever out of all of them.
I love that one too.
It's one of my, I mean, that record moves me emotionally. The sonics of the record, the way it's just everything about it. I bought that on vinyl and just, I cranked that thing still.
Yeah, there's a lot going on with that album.
So good.
Yeah. So much emotion there. Yeah. And like kind of a global consciousness about, by the way, and then I'm sorry, I'm distracted by a question. Ray, have you ever played Korn's song, My Gift to You?
My Gift to You. We did do that.
Really? How's the chorus go?
When did we do that? yeah, we did that on the Follow the Leader. And when we did the Follow the Leader, yes, we did do that song. We only did three times, though, three shows.
Remember where they were?
Yes, Vegas, San Francisco, and LA.
Okay, somebody else. Back check. Let's check.
Google it.
Yeah, I love the whole Korn catalog. It's like, of course, you know, Korn has so many hits that we have to play the number ones, and we have to play. I mean, come on, Freak on a Leash was retired. It was the only song that was ever retired off of TRL back when MTV actually played music. Remember that?
Mm-hmm.
And, they, you know, it's because it's fan based, so the fans would vote in. So Freak on a Leash was a bad win. But finally, the guy had to call me and go, dude, you got to retire. We need to give someone else a chance.
I remember that.
Yeah, sort of like they have so many hits that you have to play those. But I love the deep cuts. I love the old school Korn. I love deep cuts that we've done. You know, yeah. Songs that like you wouldn't normally, you know, play loud. Me and John talk about it all the time. Like, you should throw this in, and we just never do. You know, it's one of those. Someday we're going to come out and do like all just rare deep cuts and just, I don't know, for the diehards, you know,
the longest. We'll reinvent them all.
Well, yeah, totally. I mean, because we, even when we did that like dubstep record in 12, you know, it was like there was teenagers showing up with glow sticks. Mm-hmm. Oh my God, Skrillex, cool. Like, you know, and then we're playing Freak on a Leash and Blind. They're like, what's this song? I don't know. You can tell that they only had the dubstep record. It was weird. So that's what's cool about Korn is they're not afraid to take a left turn every once in a while and shake it up a little bit stylistically.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So what are you, Ray, do you live in Tennessee or?
I live here at Rock Falcon. I have a bunk underneath that drum case over there.
He sleeps under the door over there.
It's really cheap rent. It's like $50 a month. I do. I live in Franklin, Tennessee, which is about 25 minutes from here, 20 minutes south.
You have animals?
But 10 LA, at least I grew up on a big farm and moved to the concrete jungle for 26 years. So it feels good to just stretch out and you know, be down here. Good folks down here. Great thing for your kids. The schools are amazing. Great people live here. People like Nick keeping rock alive.
Mm-hmm. When's the next Korn album coming out?
Tomorrow. I don't know. Not sure. No one really knows. My crystal ball's in the shop, kid. That's another thing to say. Yeah, I don't know. We're always working on music and stuff, so you never know. But
does Nick have any writing credits on any of the Korn records?
Yeah. On both albums.
Yeah, I was gonna say you agree.
You wrote a bunch of those songs.
Plethora.
Yeah.
Plethora.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Nick's great too about like he'll do like, remember that tune we worked on 4 weeks ago? I'm like, no. And yeah, remember this part went like this? I think that would go good in this song. And you're like, what? I wasn't even fast. How did you even think about that? And it'll work. You're gonna like, dang, that was awesome. And the next thing you know, the song's born, you know, because of that. Or he'll, a weak part of the song is really good at canon, where we think it's like, oh, this is kick ass. And he's like, yeah, but think of this and the way it flows into the chorus or whatever, you know.
Mm-hmm.
There was many good jam sessions.
Nick's a weird, there's a lot of.
Why do you know of hard rock?
This guy is really fun to jam with.
A twirl.
Oh yeah, before we started, do you want to show people see how Zoom handles the flickering of your drumsticks?
What do you mean, Zoom handles?
Well, just the, you know, because
weird one.
We had flashing lights in our.
Did they flash?
No, but it just looks.
You twirl like, oh, I see what you're talking about. So you go between the middle finger and you go between the pinky finger. So you, people never, they don't do those ones. You got the thumb. You got the all of the fingers. That one. Can you see that? And then you got
splits. Do you think a jam is possible right now?
A jam?
Modern drummer people are like, is it possible we could do a jam? Riff Raff, what do you think? Riff Raff's terrified. What do you think? Are you guys in the mood to like make some noise?
I don't know. What are you gonna do? Are you gonna hit drums?
I don't know. Are you
This is not a pressure thing. You don't have to.
There's gonna be no lights.
But you are in a studio. And if, by the way, you know, I'm supposed to be hawking my movie Adventures of Power, which we're postponing. Anyone who wants to watch the movie, you can watch it anytime at airdrummer.com or on Amazon, and the money supports Music Cares. But if you guys are in the mood to jam,
he can jam. I'll watch. Yeah. I'll tell him if it's good or not.
why don't you pick up a bass, Nick, and like give him some bottom?
he thought about it for an eighth of a second. No. Here, we're gonna sign off with this 30-second solo. Ready?
Yeah.
Can you turn the laptop around?
Wait, you got this thing on here. What's this?
Oh, rock and roll. There it is. Perfect.
Yeah, dude. What's this? Here, we'll put name that song. Ready? How was this thing at?
Can you hear anything?
The winner, Nick will produce your next record.
I think Zoom is muting. Like as you play, it gets completely squashed. But like, try again.
What about this? What if I go?
By the way. Rod Diaz from Suicidal Tendencies wants to jam with us. He's like on the line right now. He's like trying to figure out if he can join in. But we have the technology for that. But Riff Raff is going to be the master of all things.
He's awesome, man. I love that bass player, man. I'll jam with him anytime.
Suicidal.
Yeah, dude.
Yeah. Yeah. And we had. We had Raw with Alex Skolnick and Charlie Benante last week, and they've done these incredible trio Rush cover things together, which you know sets the bar pretty high.
So good, yeah.
But anyway, so he sends his love. He's on the other end of he's watching. Yeah,
much respect.
Yeah. So maybe we'll sign off. We did our best to do a jam. The audio wasn't set up for it, but you know, you guys heard some blasty noise, some very compressed Zoom style drums.
If you would have heard what I did, it would have blew your mind.
Yeah, I was actually playing bass just then, but it was so loud and compressed you couldn't even hear it.
Yeah, you could hear it in China though.
Hey, make sure everyone stay
through the earth.
What's this movie? This is an awesome movie, and I love the uniqueness of this flick. So just everyone stay on and check this movie out.
Thank you. Yeah, it's called Adventures of Power. If you can't stay on, watch it on Amazon Prime later. And thank you guys so much for joining us. And for those of you who have watched, thank you for keeping rock alive. I know you guys all want to see shows as soon as possible, but thank you for doing this while we wait and enjoy the show.
Thank you, everyone.
Awesome, guys. Thanks.
Peace out.
See ya.
At some point, Riff Raff will tell us we're off. Or
hi, my talking. Name is Ari Gold. I directed Adventures of Power, the movie you're about to see. If you're wondering why you never heard of it, We made it outside the Hollywood system for almost no money, but fans have been asking for us to bring it back, so thank you. People ask me why I made a movie about air drumming. I think air drumming looks funny, and I hope you do too. But also, for me, air drumming, in its crazy way, gets at a spiritual and maybe even a political truth that is super relevant right now, so I hope it speaks to you. Please stick around until the very end of the credits to join us in making the world a more beautiful, more awesome, and more powerful place. Now, get ready for Adventures of Power.
The first sound we hear is the beat of our mama's heart. But then the noise of the world drowns out that beat until we can't hear it anymore. But once in a while, a person comes along and holds on to it. No matter how hard the world beats back. Imagine that.
My aunt's not feeling well.
Hello, fellas. Welcome to Youth and Young at Heart. What can we do for you today?
You got a room?
It's okay, oh, Joni.
I'm sorry, Howard. Frank's disability ran out.
It's nice outside.
I heard that they cut back pay at the plant again. Your dad's not going to strike, is he?
He doesn't talk to me that much these days.
Oh, sweetheart, I'm so sorry. Please. Oh. Please don't listen to my brother when it comes to you, Power, okay? You are a beautiful spirit. And I love that little thing you do. I love your... It's very cute.
It's not cute, Aunt Joni. People think it's amazing.
Okay. Are you sure you don't want something hot to eat there?
Joni, you can always count on cereal.
Thanks, honey.
When?
Chris said like this. You got it.
Pal, I know this chick. Her sister's on leave. Maybe we could double date to the talent show tonight.
I don't know. I want to focus on my performance.
Power, when was the last time you sucked down hussy spit?
I sucked down hussy spit all the time.
Come on. My girl can't go unless her sister goes.
Okay.
Thanks, pal. It's gonna be awesome. Bring flowers! Power's in!
So, how long you been living with your aunt, Power?
About 10 years. It's temporary. So you were stationed.
What's up, DJ?
Yeah, the horn blows, but does the driver?
You know my number.
How would life be if I were a cow? Life in the pasture, oh, what a wow. To graze in the sun, to chew my cud, and all of the time to go moo. Thank you, Power.
So what's your friend gonna do? Touch himself?
He's gonna win, lady.
Yeah, right, Tonto.
We walk through the valley, we walk through...
Doing your thing, Power?
When are you gonna do something?
I ain't touched guitar in 15 years.
Don't matter.
Right, well, rock 'em dead, Power.
Ow.
Present day.
And on the old applause meter, I would say that rated about a 6. Next up, we have a special speech, followed by Power.
Thank you. Thanks for having us to Talent Night. Look, I'm not gonna do a big song and dance here. If this strike does happen, and us boys don't have the cash to buy a cerveza for my hippie sister here, that don't mean that we don't love you. We do. Are we gonna let Dick Houston kill this town after we made Houston Tricord what it is?
No!
We're gonna win this thing.
What's up, Power? You got a rocket, brother?
That's right.
Shut your trap, Bobby.
Hey, you can watch, Dad? Boys love it.
They're making fun of you, Power. Come on, look at yourself. Gay shoes, gay jeans, gay. And I actually like the headband. You know, I named you Power so that you'd be strong. I wanted you to be a man, not a pussyfooter.
I'm not pussyfooting. I'm double bass drumming.
Joni! Start the tape!
Nickels and dimes, overtime. They got you working so you just might lose your mind. Your ears ringing, your eyes stinging. The baby comes to box, man, just robs you blind.
Power!
Free!
The plan, only you will command to write the plot, cause what not? You'll be a Superman, impossible.
You, my friend.
Yeah. What? That was amazing.
This place is boring. Let's go.
Ladies, wait.
Why don't you play real drums, Power?
Doing here, Dad?
My sister making you sleep outside again?
sorry you missed your performance.
What?
Sorry you missed your performance.
What a performance, Power. Look, I've been working for that company since I was 17 years old. And they promised us that if we worked hard and saved up, then we'd have a decent life, and so would our kids. But now they're rich, and they think they can just throw us out like garbage. So I'm trying to tell people they gotta stick together and they gotta keep at it before they choke this whole town.
That's what I'm doing too.
Yeah, with this?
Well, if you listen to the words.
Is that what it's about? The words?
Well, no, it's about the drumming.
You don't even have any drums.
Well, you would never let me. I know it's too late for me to learn to play drums. Well, I can still rock.
Power, I love you. Because you're part of your mother. But you can't keep doing this to me. You gotta stop.
No, you listen to me. It could do you good. You know, like that part in Tom Sawyer where Neil Peart goes, I mean, I can't really do it, but, I mean, you know, it's the feeling, Dad. I could bring this feeling to everyone. You know, did you see tonight?
It's gonna be trouble tomorrow.
I know, I'm here to help.
You stay out of it, Power.
I got your back, Dad!
About a double wide, I work hard but still I'm broke. I live like you, I salute the flag with pride, like I was talked to by my folks.
You think you know the time? Little bit like you, I got problems in my life. A little bit like you, I try.
You
good? A little like you.
Heck of a song, boy. Good to see you playing real drums.
Real drums is the bomb, Dad.
You moved that hotel I gave you, boy?
Yep.
Yeah? What about your cologne? What's it called again?
Sweat. We're selling buckets.
You bagging fillies right quick?
Word up. You know it.
So, Pa,
remember that crazy thing I used to do?
I gave you drums, didn't I? Give you everything you need, right?
Yeah. No, I know. I was just thinking there's this contest and...
No! You are not gonna start that abomination again, are you? Because it's wrong.
Nah, dawg. I'm a drummer, Dad. I'm a real drummer now. You know that. I was just kidding you. I was just kidding.
Good. Good. That's good. You make me proud, boy.
Come along!
Oh. Yeah. I got it, Paul.
Good boy.
Chambliss.
What's going on out there in New Mexico?
I've got my eye on them.
I want to know who's causing trouble.
Yep.
Power. Sorry, guys. What are you standing there for?
Alan, don't you do this to me.
I didn't want to. Walkout is in progress. Over.
See you, brothers, at the town hall.
Mr. Houston is going to destroy you.
We're striking.
That's right, Power. Workers are striking.
How can I help?
You can't. You're not a striker.
Well, yes, I am. I'm right here with you.
You can't strike if you've been fired, Power.
Nice going, Power. Dad?
What do I do now, Sid?
Come on, pal. Remember when my dad died? You said drumming can save anybody.
I must have been wrong. You got nothing.
Look out!
Batala?
Battle?
De los tambores.
Of drums?
None. Drums. Permit?
It's an air drum contest in Mexico! Tonight!
There's a place for people like me.
It's only 40 miles. Take my bike.
I can't just leave everybody.
Power, we got something special that nobody here understands. Don't waste it.
I was born to run, I was born to dream. The craziest boy you ever seen. I gathered you in my way.
And we will strike at every single tricorp plant across this nation until we are heard.
Yeah. And I was here to please. I'm even
I'm here for the contest.
Él es mi amigo. You my friend.
Yeah.
It's a mighty hard road that my poor hand is holding. My poor feet is traveled a hot, dusty road. Out of your dust bowl and westwards we rolled, and your desert was hot and your mountains was cold. Well, it's always we ramble that river and I down along your green valley. I will work till I die, and this land I'll defend with my life if it be, because my pastures of plenty must always be free. Yeah, we work in your orchards of peaches and prunes, sleep on the ground neath the light of your moon. On the edge of your city you will see us, and then we come with the dust and we go with the wind.
Dear Sid, tell Joni I love her. And tell the boys I'm praying for them. And for my dad too. I'll send you money for a bike as soon as I can. I just need to find out why the universe made me want to drum, but never gave me the chance.
But I know things will be different in Newark. Maybe people will understand me there.
Welcome to Newark!
They say it's lonely in the big city, but I believe anyone can make a friend.
Not the apron, man!
Love, power.
Hi, I'm Power.
Use new members. After all, the end is near.
Oh, it's the near. Oh. Yes, yes. Find it on your side here later.
Thank you.
Those are bad boys. What are you doing in this neighborhood?
I'm looking for a place called Carlos Gym. I'm a rock and roll drummer.
Rock? Rock is the devil's music, child.
Goodbye.
Good night, Fang.
Yeah.
What a shame.
Time for bed. Oh, okay. Yeah. Good.
Sinner.
Mr. Power, my husband like your name. Can you do mop?
I'm a good worker.
You sleep here. Flat noodle, low main noodle, power noodle.
Hi, I'm Power. Thanks for your help last night. What's your name?
You see, she's busy.
Catch you later. Stuff, Chief.
Cause spaghetti heads like you got no rhythm.
Spaghetti heads.
I was born in this country and I love rock music.
Freedom.
We have got to be ready for anything.
It ain't my fault, Senor.
I am
waiting for music.
Imagine that.
How much you bench, Power?
What?
Take off your shirt, Chief.
Window. Calm down. Take it easy, man.
Whoa! You didn't tan, dude. You're hurting my eyes.
So wear sunglasses.
Why are you here, Power? Me? Papa Legba tell me to play. Ernesto, why do you do this?
Makes me sexy.
Tell him about me.
Law here was kicked out of the Air Sitar Society.
Brando?
Shouldn't even be here.
You're just like the rest of us.
I can play drums.
Oh, yeah, yeah, sure you can't. How about you, Power?
Hmm?
Why are you here? You like drums?
Well, I always wanted to play drums, but I guess I never got the chance. You know, but then the first time I heard Tom Sawyer by Rush, I felt the music flow through me. It felt so good. It felt like the whole world was coming alive. And then people were like, what are you doing? I don't know.
Nobody understands, do they?
Well, it's not their fault.
Oh, yes, it is.
But I don't get it either. There has to be a reason we do this.
You bet your sweet ass there is. Go into my office, Paul.
What?
I got the back of my barn, and now you're adding in some waxy whip from the booties?
Why are you outsourcing Jersey?
Brandog, we need a low tom to complete the set. You know that. Suck it up, man. Sit down. Don't worry about Brain Dog. He'll come around. But we got a bigger problem right now, Power. You want to turn that on for me, please?
I'm here to talk about my video. A little like you.
Yes.
Who's that?
A cowboy, a billionaire, a drummer. Imagine that. Clips his toenail and it sells on eBay. Now, a drum company is staging this air drum fight to promote their product. For them, it's just a stunt. But the winning crew gets $2,000. Now, that's real money. And that's our chance to show the world that we are legit. Problem is, this pretty boy just signed up. And he don't even like air drumming.
So how could he win if he doesn't love it?
This clown gets applause just for showing up. Accuracy, because he plays real drums. And he can last all night because he does not give his all like my boys do. You know, any fool can play drums. It's easy. But when you have got to bounce your hands off air, when you've got to bounce your hands off the substance of life, down, up, up, down, that is a double workout. You know that. I know that. But these clowns, they want to make a joke out of us. You know what I'm saying? Paul, you know how it feels to be laughed at for doing something that you love.
I do.
Do you know how it feels to cry in the dark?
I do.
Do you know how it feels to touch yourself with no hands? Then let's show these bastards that we are better than they are.
We're not better, we're just different.
No, no, we're better.
Different.
Better.
Different.
We're better.
Okay. You used to be a drummer, didn't you?
Best funk band in Jersey.
Why'd you quit?
Are you blind? Slot machine in Atlantic City. Took my last quarter. And no sissies there? They kicked me out of the band. What they forgot was music is not about having arms. Music is about having spirit. And I had the last laugh when Def Leppard just kept on pumping out the hits. All right. Here's the scoop.
If our crew qualifies for the team round, we gotta make one big drum set. Brain Dogs on kick, Oberlin's on crash, Ornesto's keeping the backbeat. And Law plays a mean hi-hat.
Law may not be as pretty as our cowboy friend there, but he's got lungs like a blue whale. The man is loose, he's flowing, he's strong. Put him in it. A real air drummer has a genuine shot at the title, okay? But where I need you, where I need you at, Power, where I really, really need you, is on the low tom, in the team round. All right, it's not a glamorous job, and you only got 10 days to train. What do you say, Power, huh?
Low tom?
Low tom. Welcome to the crew. Grab yourself some weights, man. Go get yourself in shape.
Potty?
Where are your pony buns?
I'm alone here.
I can't sleep. It's so loud.
Are you Chinese?
Are you retarded? Do I look Chinese to you?
You sound Chinese.
I'm deaf, you idiot.
Wait. If you can't hear me, how am I keeping you awake?
I can feel you.
You can? I can't. I don't know this
Giant.
Song. Me too.
Hello. They killed two strikers in Peru last year. What makes you
think? This ain't Peru. Gonna win this.
Keep it up, brothers!
Guys! Paris sent me a postcard.
He should send you a new bike.
He says he has a girlfriend, and she's totally deaf.
Deaf?
That means she's hot, dude. And he says he's gonna compete in the air drum fight in New York City.
But what? That freak. Let me see that.
No, I'm not supposed to.
Maybe if I'd bought him drums when he was a kid, he'd be over this by now.
Harlan. When you see my dad, don't tell him I wrote. Just tell him a joke or something so he smiles today. Love, Powell.
You see that?
So, Mr. Harlan,
how many Navajos does it take to screw the light?
Get a job, losers!
It is ours, yo! Come check out my crib.
Oh, yeah.
Yo, what's up, yo? Yo, camera guy, check this out. Boom! I taught him that. Check this out. Yo, what up? See, this is where I do all my dance routine. You know, I get and I represent like that. You know? Now this is where the dub of genius fly. That is where I get nice on the drums. Look at that. Isn't she a beauty? And that. Yeah, that's where the magic happens.
Sexy, sexy, sexy.
Hey, baby, come here. Come here. Come here. Go away. I love that. Oh,
that's bad.
Dallas, so what is next for Dallas H? Politics?
I gotta tell you, I do it all. You know, I got my animated series, got my non-stick cooking spray. Mm-hmm. I just take life as it comes.
Right, right. So what is this rumor I hear then about this air drumming competition on Friday night?
Where'd you hear about that?
This interview is over. Come on. So we're all right, I got what I need.
What you looking at? Get out of here.
Don't touch the shirt, mate.
What do you think you're doing, boy?
Gentlemen, I know you remember the sound of your mama's heartbeat. We are brothers keeping that beat. Your heart never gets tired of beating. Why should you? Every beat of your heart makes you hurt.
Imagine that. Mm. No, you're not feeling anything.
Yes, I am.
What are you feeling?
I'm feeling really proud to be playing low tom.
Bovine maneuver.
Okay, fine. I'm feeling frustrated. I came all this way. I thought it'd be different here. I thought it'd be somebody.
All right. See, you have got to use that anger, man. That's what I'm talking about. You're too tight to play right.
What's that supposed to mean?
That means you're just the low tom.
Low toms are important too.
Tight ones?
What's wrong with power?
He's too tight to play right.
Take
off his shorts.
I thought you a good Christian girl.
I'm here, Mr. Fong. Take them off.
Can't wear those, Annie.
I'm making you feel great.
Oh, you think my drumming's tight too?
Well, maybe if you loosened up, that the music would really show.
What do you know about music?
Accuracy and flair. This is how I'll beat the cowboy thrice over.
That's it. What do you wear?
I'm loose.
You couldn't make us look like a bunch of pansies. Put on some pants.
Hey.
You put pants on your head.
Shut up, Jihad boy.
I'm sick of you people. Stop behaving like kids, okay?
He started.
Manny got knife, but it banned it.
What is with you people? We have a fight tomorrow, guys. Now get back here. Come on, guys. Everybody huddle up. Men, look at me. Jersey born and raised, so I am a natural Jersey boy. But Lol is a Jersey boy now too, brain dog. And so is Power, no matter what he's wearing. And so is everybody who's ever lived on a prayer. They call New Jersey the armpit of the nation, but that is not an insult, gentlemen. Without an armpit, we couldn't sweat. Without an armpit, we couldn't work. Without an armpit, we'd be buying rock and roll from the Chinese.
I love my armpit.
Yes. Well, all right then. Men, we've got one chance to be a team or to be nothing forever.
I'm so sorry about the shorts. I should have believed.
It will break my mother's heart if she saw me with.
God, Raka.
Why? Because it's the devil's music.
Because I'm all she has.
Wasting what I got anymore.
I wish there was something special that I could do.
Annie, you are special. You actually feel things. The rest of the world just plays along.
Not everybody, Bella. You play with passion.
That's because melodic rock saved my life. Rush, Styx, Journey. I wish I could show you how beautiful it is to me.
I wish you could, too. You have the thin, yet supple lips of Steve Perry.
You have the golden locks of David Lee Roth. Feels me.
Sex is a sacred package only to be opened in marriage.
I didn't open the package.
No.
Annie!
I'm going to call the police.
You can't keep her to yourself. You have to let her rock.
Police! Oh, Annie, no!
Take
no!
My sister and my roving son and all of my brave brothers and sisters in their fight against oppression and greed. Amen.
I can feel it coming in the air tonight. Oh, love. And I've been waiting for this moment for all my life.
Oh,
have a chance to say something to the world. And as a team, we can win. I don't care how much money the opposition has, how popular they are, how good looking. Tonight, we are air drummers. Every one of us.
Imagine that.
Harlan, I need my paycheck.
All we're asking of Houston is that he keep his promises.
How about the union keeping its promises? We can't feed our kids on nothing.
Just hold out another couple of days, and Houston will come to the table.
Some poor slobs here from Mexico to take our jobs? You ain't crossing this line, scabs!
Get your families home. Those aren't scabs. Get on your bike and get out of here. Go home! Let me handle this.
The hurt doesn't show, but the pain still grows. Some stranger to you and me.
Mexico may soon be over. The strike hospitalized today after they viciously.
You have a phone?
Power, stay focused.
Oh, Power, you look pale, man.
As usual. I'll take care of that.
I need to call my family.
What are you doing?
What's the problem? I'm almost in town to New York City.
I'll be right back.
What
are you doing, man?
Sorry.
You have to be kidding me.
You little pussy.
It was a pussy.
Hey, shut up. You're starting to piss off.
Operator.
Hello?
Hey, Joni, it's Power.
Yeah, hold on. Harlan. It's Power.
Hello?
I'm sorry. I shouldn't
have left. Should have been there.
I'm sorry, Power. You know, I never could afford to raise you and watch out for you and buy you drums.
Forget drums. I just wanted to be like you.
Don't you get it? I want you to be better.
They beat us today. They beat us with sticks. We didn't have sticks. Had spirit, just like you.
These boys are down for the count. we felt something today. Something in us could change.
They need you. The Lord needs you.
I need you.
I love you, Dad. I'm right there with you. Now I got a job to do.
I know you do, son. So do it.
Carpa Local 832, Load, New Mexico.
Yo, pal, you're supposed to be in New York already.
How'd you know?
Local 185.
We heard what happened. We're praying for your pot and the boys.
Yeah, we're praying they don't quit.
They don't quit.
Get in the boat, brother.
This thing. We offer them $8 an hour and we're done with it.
That's the way I want to hear you talk, boy.
Now, these guys don't have the guts to pick it anymore.
We took care of that.
Hey, come on in.
In the qualifying round, each drummer will fight to collect applause points for their crew. They will also be
monitored by the Bakir cymbal drum matching machine. To the death!
Glory!
The most eligible bachelor in the USA. Pop star, fashion designer, and also baby animal activist, Dara Zane!
That jerk is playing my song.
They mean Dallas Houston?
Oh.
Forget the cowboy. It's nothing.
Tastes good cologne.
Position, Olympia crew.
In second position, yes, crew.
Yes, we're in. And in the lead, Team Dallas Edge.
Hey, thanks for gracing us with your presence.
We made it to the group round. That's what counts, all right?
In the group round, crews must play as a single drum set. And then each crew will send its star drummer to survive our challenge song, Face to Face and to the Death.
Oh, this is the from Power.
Mom, I can't go to Florida.
I know. Maybe Jesus is a rocker, too.
What counts now is that we stay strong this round. Make up some lost points. Law's gonna kill in the endurance round, all right? Mm. Let's see how the girls are playing it. Three! For the endurance round. Just hold on to second position.
Power, where you going?
Every time.
Hey, you think what we do is a joke?
What do you want, freak?
I just want you to play hard. Respect what we're doing.
I respect music. I actually play the drums.
Yeah, well, real drums are fine, too. But not everybody
you
has
know,
them.
No, there wouldn't even be cymbals if it weren't from my family.
What do you mean?
My daddy mines copper.
So is mine.
Screaming!
They're not the only ones with tricks up their sleeves.
Go, go, go! Let's hear it for the boys from the Breach and Tunnel! Contest. Hand drumming is not air drumming.
This is un-American.
Val can drum however he wants.
He's a Jersey boy now.
Randolph, easy. You're our pinch hitter now. Let me handle this.
This is drum racism. Look, Randolph, Randolph.
You are disqualified! Oh, there is blood coming out of my nose! A tissue, please! Oh my God, I'm bleeding! The crowd is going wild!
Power! It's all your power! You gotta represent for Alton! You gotta represent for Jersey!
The leader of the Jersey crew has been disqualified for using no air sticks! Three other members of the crew have been eliminated for touching my sweet patented meter. This leaves one low-ranking member to compete. He is at a huge disadvantage.
Shut your trap.
Bobby.
Get me my boy.
Hang up the phone, Dallas. I got a break. What?
Get me my boy. I'll give you hit songs.
I'll give you hotels. I'll give you
the best genetic code in history.
And you go and humiliate our family.
I'm just showing everybody what a bunch of losers air drummers are.
You can't fool me.
Don't you get it? I can do whatever I want. The world loves me. They hate you.
So what?
So what is?
Maybe this is who I really am.
What have they done to my boy? All right. You listen to me. Houston doesn't lose. You hear me? Houston doesn't lose.
Don't worry, Daddy-o. It's in the bag.
Come on, guys, it's not over. We got one round left.
Power can't catch the Rasisco. It's impossible. He's got to outlast Dallas by half a stick. And Dallas barely moved his arms.
As long as the contestants play correctly, the sticks will light up towards victory. Given Dallas's great advantage at this point, the other competitors will have to outlast him by at least 20 seconds to win.
Which is no easy feat.
Because this song destroys drummers instantly.
All right, listen to me. I want you to sit square on the stool. Do not waste your energy, okay? And breathe, Power, breathe. I don't want you dying on me. But you can earn us some respect out there. Now listen, we don't know what they're gonna play. But whatever it is, it's not gonna be easy. But I know you. You're loose now. So use it.
But low time's pretty tight.
Yeah. But cymbals shake and sway. And they give off a golden sound. You gotta be the whole set now, Bawa. The whole set.
Carlos?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Get out there.
Well, now you get some. Yeah.
It's not-
Hey, you! You never even played drums, did you?
I don't need drums. I am drums.
Wow.
Neil Peart.
Great job, Howard.
Hi, Neil. Mr. Peart?
Neil.
What would you like to do with your half?
It's not much, but...
Make my half out to Copper Workers Local 832, Low, New Mexico.
Howard, can you take out too?
All right, let's get back on that line! Yeah!
Working hard, Lord knows they work you to the bone. And
Hello.
You're still here.
Thank you.
So,
if you want to binge,
you can join us at adventuresofpower.com, where we have dozens,
actually hundreds
of videos with rock stars and great stuff. So please say hello. And just so you know, a big portion of the proceeds from watching this movie go to support musicians and other people who are in need in this difficult time. So please spread the word about this movie to your friends, to your family, and your social media right now. And every time someone watches the movie, it helps to save a life. Seriously. So donate to the charity. Come visit us. Ask your friends to watch. They may be looking for something besides cat videos and apocalypse. So please join us. Maybe other people need power too. I know I do. Okay. Bye. See you there.
Hi, my name is Ari Gold. I directed Adventures of Power, the movie you're about to see. If you're wondering why you never heard of it, we made it outside the Hollywood system for almost no money.